here that we had, the back of the semi, go through that door and you go into the big cage and on through there into the other little cages where the animals were at. And I had this little tent here with some animals in it, 10 cent show. That's about what I made too, is 10 cents. That's the side wall around the show and the other little animal show beside it. We were over Cuba for 2 or 3 months. That's the colored fellow that helped us over there, real good helper. He says, I know you don't believe it, but it's true. This is more Cuban people. This must be at a like a little outdoor restaurant or something. Had a lot of little places that you buy something to eat. They'd put it in a piece of paper for you. Some of the stuff that was in Cuba. People in Cuba. There are streets in Cuba. I guess they're still driving some of them same cars over there. They were all good, friendly people. This is the market section where you go down there and buy stuff. We're good, friendly people, but that was before Castro. Batista was the president then. There was another, that was a helper also. She was an interpreter like for us. Not sure where these pictures were taken. Well, I believe we're still in Cuba. Yeah, we're still in Cuba. We're following the truck, jump from one spot to the other. And played different towns over there in Cuba. I remember Batabano. That was over on the other side of Cuba. There's the semi in Cuba, the show truck in Cuba. And I actually went from the Texas border to New York State, from the Mexican border in Texas to across the New York State border, up through New York State, and all in between, including Cuba. That was the means of transportation for the sugar cane, the oxen team. This is crabs strung up on a piece of string. They run the string through the crabs, and they were a string of crabs. And that was our interpreter there and helper, and Bob Noell, cooking the crabs. He's getting ready to cook the crabs. One of the spots we played in Cuba. Well, we're into some home movies here now. I don't know just who's who here. I'll have to figure it out. It's Aunt Ruth. Piece of fish. Must have been having a fish fry. There's Daddy. Bob Noell. Yep. Cooking brim. There's Sweetie Noell. My father's brother. Virginia Mountains, whole pictures here that kind of got faded out before the Skyline Drive, along the Skyline Drive. Well, these are very old home movies here that had two gorillas tied out on chains there playing with them when they were younger. And I'm not sure which two it is, probably Tommy and Topsy. A little carnival someplace on the eastern seaboard, no doubt. And here's some old pictures. That's Gene on the left there. Not a very good picture of Gene. Doc Etling there on the left. The man that raised my father, put him in show business. My mother's brother, which is my Uncle Bubs Roach, and his wife sat beside him. Uncle Bubs. A lady from South Carolina, I believe. Must have been having a fish fry there or something. There's the show set up beside a store someplace. Oh, that was in South Carolina, along 301, I believe, or Route 1 in South Carolina. Little town in South Carolina. Some retired vaudeville show people that had a little restaurant. We set up there beside their place. There they are out there doing some of their old routines. There's Jean and Robert. Jean is probably pregnant there with Chris. She wouldn't want to turn around, probably. On the jiggly board. And there's Helen Roach, Bubs's wife. Bob smoking his pipe. This looks like it might be, yes, that's the Mustard and Gravy team, the blackface comedian that used to work out of Wilson, North Carolina. Ernest Stokes, I think he still has his son right there on the left. He still has a clothing store in Wilson, North Carolina. They went out to California, made a couple of movies, Noell Western movies. Looks like it's one of the races at the fairground or something. It says some fun, huh? It's the flood. It's the Reidsville, North Carolina flood. It was water came up on the lot about 2-3 feet deep up in the house trailers and the trucks. We all had to be pulled off the lot with a Caterpillar tractor, and it wasn't much fun. It doesn't look like it's anything visible right there at the moment, but that's the Spitfire ride. You don't see them on the road anymore. And trucks was mired up, bogged down in. That's our show truck there. That's our main cage wagon, wrestling arena, and getting stuck was a common occurrence back then. The lots were all muddy. It was something that happened quite often. Steps that Debbie took. These pictures are kind of old, but I think this is Debbie, and this is the first steps that Debbie took. Done a little bit of sitting down with their first few steps. Some of these pictures got wet, old pictures, and some of them were shot and they cut everybody's head off because for one reason or another they didn't hold it. That's probably Sister and Debbie again. And pretty well chopped up because these films got wet and they've been hot and they never had a place to be that the humidity would be any good. So Skyline Drive, that they took a little trip on the Skyline Drive, took some pictures there, and then there's some home movies coming up here. Now that's me and Sister. I'm 56 now. And I was about 6 then, so this picture is about 50 years old. That was a couple of little dogs that we had. And in 1943, these pictures were taken. So I believe we were in the woods in Texas, I think. It was out... Yeah, the armadillo. Yeah, we was on an armadillo hunt. We caught a Texas armadillo there. Carried that armadillo up into Virginia. People up in Virginia never saw one of those things before. Had a metal box he would kept him in. his sister, and Bobby Noell. Back in 1943. I think that little dog, we picked that dog up in New Orleans. Went back to New Orleans a year later and the dog left the first few days there. Must have knew where it wanted to go. Got lost and found its way back home or something. Stayed with us for a year. Of course, it may have just got run over too or something. Always wondered what happened to the dog, though. We took it back holding the armadillo up for the tail. We followed a group of soldiers that were cavalry soldiers through Texas, and they went 15 or 20 miles a day, and we went along, set up a show where they could see the show at night, and it was something that I remember because most of those cavalry soldiers went over to Europe with the horses, all got slaughtered because you can't hide a man with a horse trying to take care of a horse, and they all got almost all of them were got killed in war, killed in battle. Big cactuses out there along the Mexican border in Texas, and that's where these pictures were taken, and they've held up pretty good. I guess these were probably 16 millimeter at the time. They didn't have 8 back then. No soundtrack. Funny looking little riding pants I had on. Adobe Hacienda. That house is like the houses in Mexico and along the Texas border, made out of clay, mud blocks, mud and sticks. And that's what people lived in. And on down in Mexico and Central America, I guess you could still find some like that. Pretty good movies to be as old as they are. They held up pretty good under the conditions they've been kept under. I'm going to do a magic act. See, here I do magic now, but this is my own magic act. I do a good disappearing act myself. Well, got somebody out of the drum there. Well, by golly, that drum was, it was crowded, I'll tell you. I believe that's Sonny Herndon there. I'm not sure who that is on the right. That might be George. That's Shirley Poindexter. That's my cousins. This is, maybe Douglas, maybe? Maybe sister there. Oh, Uncle Palmer, he got out last. And the dog says, boy, I can't figure this stuff out here. He just puts his foot over his ear. I was a pretty good jumper there, too, if you notice. Boy, I could jump right around when I was... A dog could jump up my arms, I'd grab it. My hat would fly in the wind, and I'd grab it when it'd come by. I believe this fellow, the young fellow there, was Gilly. I think this is sister. And this is Shirley Poindexter. He's doing a card trick too. He's grabbing them right out of the thin air there. Shirley Poindexter, my cousin that lives in Bedford County, Virginia. Never has made it to Florida. If he has, I've never seen him here. Here we are back in Texas now. We're going to do this disappearing act with sister. I'm going to try to make her disappear. Yep, she's gone. The dog went with her. Calling for sister now. Okay, going to do the hocus pocus, and there she is again. Didn't bring the dog back, though, if you notice. Dog says, I don't believe this baloney. We always had a big old Great Dane dog. They always had several dogs. This is Johnny Roach. He's pretty good too. He can stand on his head from the backwards position. Ninky Roach. See what he's going to do. He's going to try something the same way. He's going to flip over backwards. No, he's going to. The wind was blowing hard that day. Off into the wild blue yonder we fly. Ninky Roach. There goes Bobby Noell. And the propulsion is by Johnny there. That's Johnny's propulsion. Sister trying it. Boom, she hit kind of hard there. Here we come down the hill. 3, 2. Golly, there's only one left. There we all are. Ninky, Johnny, Bobby, and Sister. There's a stump there. And that had a hole in the bottom of it there. It was kind of hard to get through, but if you worked it just right, you could crawl out through the stump. So we're going to see if we can't crawl out through the stump. That's the stump, an old stump on a lot that we were showing on there. And a tree stump, you notice. Well, here comes the first one out. That's Johnny. Well, there goes Johnny. Let's see who's next in that hole there. We had to scratch that hole out bigger to get Sister in there. I think we got one or two more down in there. It was cramped as can be down in there. Yeah, there comes Ninky. Ninky out of the stump. Surely I must be in the bottom, huh? Yeah, there I am. I'm down on the bottom. Well, there's Granddaddy Roach. Looks like he's catching a siesta. His lips going, fluttering in the breeze. And there's their little dog. That's my granddaddy. I forget the name of that little dog. That was the Roach family dog. There's Sister again, making funny faces. I told her she shouldn't be doing that. Some of that might hang around. Riding the tricycle. We're using the props that the animals use. Some of those props were what the animals rode around on the stage on, that little bicycle and stuff, and the scooter. We did acts for the animals in places like school auditoriums. She's mad. She threw dirt on me. There's Joe. That's the chimp that bit my father. It's the father of Congo. There's Sister. She's all sportied up there. Color pictures. That's a winter bloomer, and that's a southern plant, so we had to be in, like, Louisiana there. The house trail over in the background. Probably in New Orleans. That's a fort right out of New Orleans, I believe. Fort's right out of New Orleans, Louisiana. I believe that fort still stands there. Open until 5 in the evening, then it's closed. I think me and the wife just missed going in that fort a couple of years ago when we went to New Orleans. We got there just at 5 o'clock and they were locking the gate. These pictures were taken, I think, on 16mm film in 1991. Only a few weeks ago, they were changed over to video, so I hope to be able to send some videos to the people that I'd like to have seen gotten them 10 years ago, but that's the way the ball bounces. I guess that's me and possibly my father, I don't know. The bears at the New Orleans Zoo. Had a big Kodiak bear there, pretty big bears. wintertime blooming plant grow in Louisiana, in the south, Florida. I think the plant is supposed to be poison. Of course, that's if you eat it. You're not supposed to eat them. Me and sister, I was saluting all the time. Everything was Army back in the 40s, early 40s back. Everything was the war efforts and all. I was always saluting. Banana trees growing in New Orleans. Film's getting a little fuzzy there. St. Louis Cathedral. 1794 the thing was built. Rainier, one-man submarine. I think that's in a museum there in New Orleans. And one of the early submarines of our time, the New Orleans statue. Mardi Gras in New Orleans, probably about 1943, 44. All the fags and drag in New Orleans, Mardi Gras time. My father saw this film recently and he said, you know, we used to have a good meal that we could eat for 12 cents there at a little restaurant on a side street in New Orleans. 12 cents, 12 pennies in about 1943, 44. Hard to imagine today that you could eat a meal for 12 cents. Home movies here now. That's me. And eating a candy apple, looks like, there in New Orleans. And Daddy. And we're back in Virginia now, because there's Aunt Ruth. Mildred. Mildred Noell, Douglas, Sonny Herndon, Thomas Poindexter, playing with a whip. He had his riding pants on too. I guess that was me there. I guess this must be up a little few more years. This wasn't quite that sister, playing with a whip. I always had a whip to play with. I believe that's Douglas, Alice, Aunt Ruth. Uncle Palmer. Pulling his gut out there. Leonard's wife, Leonard's wife, his name slips me, it's Doc Etling. And the show in the background, with the canvas half rolled up, Uncle Palmer, Aunt Ruth. I don't know what they're looking, oh, I think we're getting ready to hang somebody. Yeah, that's Thomas Poindexter back here. And sister with Congo. Yeah, there's, he said, I don't want to be held out like this. What are you doing to me? And Mama, there's Mama with Congo. Anna Mae Noell, the Virginia Mountains. I shortened this by about 2 hours of parades, and different circuses and animal acts and lions and this, that, and the other, trying to get the home people in, and kind of hard to figure out what just to take out unless you go back and forth through it, and I have about 30, 40 hours of tapes to go through. Counting my mother's tapes and my own tapes. 8, Super 8, 16, video, beta, and regular. Time to do away with another animal act. That's Will Hill. Thomas Poindexter. I guess the trip that he made to Florida on his motorcycle with Ernestine. That's Hoxie Tucker, and that's me there on the right with my riding helmet on. That's about the time I started riding a motorcycle. I was about 13. See Will Hill's Lincoln Continental in the background back there. I think he'll own some elephants. I don't know if that's his elephants or not. Here we are at Mustard and Gravy again. This is Ernest Stokes, Doc Edling, going by so fast. Bubs. We went by a lot of people. I couldn't aim them, going by them too fast. Spartan House Trail. I think they got that Spartan about 1946. There's Betty Sugars, one of my old girlfriends in Clearwater, Florida. Betty Sugars. And there's me. Yep. Yeah. Bubs. Doc Edling. This was taken in Clearwater, Florida, down near the Kapok Tree, just off of Gulf to Bay. About less than a mile from the Kapok Tree restaurant. It's all grown up back in there now. Ann Dufresne, I believe, is her name. It's the people that, her husband, Dutch Dufresne, it's the people that got us to come to Clearwater. Met them in Miami, and they said they had a place that you could bring the animals to and the trucks and everything in Clearwater, so we wound up coming to Clearwater, and that's why I met, how I, the reason I met my wife. Betty, and that's the Sugars family, that's the mother and father to Betty Sugars. Girl I got acquainted with there when we were staying down there. Betty Sugars. No, that may not be Betty there. Betty was bigger than that. That's Betty there. That's Betty's mother. That's Bob Noell. Alice and their automobile back there. The Spartan trailer. Doc Etling. Doc and Alice, husband and wife. Me and Betty Sugars. By golly, with a scene like this, I gotta sneak a kiss somewhere. Yeah, I see it coming. No, she said, no, not on camera. Red and Rusty, two little orangs. Taking the body out. This was a merry-go-round that went off the side of a hill. I believe going into Dunkirk from Little Valley in New York State. Ran off the road on a steep grade with a merry-go-round truck and tore it all to pieces. Hit a tree about. The tree was almost big around as a Volkswagen and knocked it over. If Danny hadn't wrecked on that hill, I was driving a semi behind him. I was about an hour, less than an hour behind him, probably 30 minutes behind him. And my mother and father stopped there, and I saw their truck stop down the hill, and I started to try to stop, and I never had brakes on the back of that semi. It was a heavy rig for a little tractor, hydraulic brakes, but vacuum brakes never worked on the trailer. And I, like, never got that truck stopped, but I did get it stopped just before the hill turned straight down, right where Danny had run off at. He'd doubled back. It was his second trip that day. He took one ride over and came back and got the merry-go-round and took it over and didn't quite make it. There was merry-go-round horses everywhere and tore all to pieces. The truck was brought up. The tractor was brought out in three or four different parts. The front axle, the rear axle, the frame. Cab was all tore to pieces. And that was painted on the side of some of the on the trailer it was loaded in. They probably used the trailer that it was loaded in for a girl show front or something. I don't remember. Danny was from Shelby, North Carolina, a real handsome young man, about 22, 25 years old. That would have been in the fall of the year, about September. Just before jumping south. Part of the tractor, they pulled it up. Wasn't much left of it. Front axle was still laying there. And I really believe if he hadn't went off that hill, I would have been down at the bottom of the hill myself, because it was really a steep downgrade and there was no way I could have got that thing stopped. Dog, she had a little puppy dog she'd play with, take good care of it too, wouldn't hurt it. Wouldn't let it get away either though, wanted it for company. Carry it around. Take good care of it. If you notice, she's tied by the back foot. In with the female gorilla. It was an ordinary sight to come around any time in the daytime, it's still a common sight, even today in 1991, to see people playing with the animals there. Most of the animals that they're playing with now are younger, because my parents were a little older and they don't take the larger animals out. But there's little orangs out there and they handle them to chimps every day. They have to take them in the trailer at night with them. They have places they keep them. Right in the house until they get a little older and bigger, and then they're kept in a larger, bigger cage outside the house instead of in the house. I might have been taking them pictures. I was a little happy on the zoom there. Zoom in and out and zoom in and out. I had a camera and I got the zoom. I had to try that zoom out. I don't know that that was me. I know I was guilty one time of doing that. Whenever you're making home movies, remember, put people in the movies that you know. Good pictures here of Tommy with Daddy. Bite him on the behind. Tommy was noted for that. And tearing shirts off. He'd get the shirt and wind up tearing off. The gorilla trainer there, you see the club that he keeps in his right hand there to keep that big thing under control there. pictures are a little more recent here. Probably no more than 20 years old.
Thank you.
Well, that's Robert. It was Uncle Palmer holding Robert. That's Robert Earl Noell Jr. And that's Robert and Congo. I came up with Snooky and Robert kind of come up with Congo. Second generation. Jim's second generation of people. Kind of grew up together. Congo's still sitting down there in the zoo, and every time I go by his cage, I gotta go get him a candy bar or something, because he knows me just as well as he ever knew me. These pictures are of Robert Jr. when he was a little guy, about 3 years old. Pictures taken over 35 years ago. You can tell by the way they look, they're kind of old. That's Joe looking at my father's hand after he bit the fingers off of it. Chip that bit him. This is Joe and Sister's wedding, I guess. What you was looking at a while ago, Daddy, cleaning Joe's fingernails up because the wrestling and boxing, if the gloves ever came off of him, he didn't want him to have much fingernails because Joe would go to your face with his fingers. I think this is Joe and Sister somewhere around the wedding days. Well, it's good that some pictures came out pretty good. Held on. That's Debbie learning to walk, Sister there with her. And she's getting around pretty good there. She'd take a few steps. That deep grass. Whoop, little hole there. And little Joey. No, that's Chris. That's Christopher. And that's a gorilla with a muzzle on. Not many times have we put a muzzle on a gorilla, but getting them broke into a muzzle where you could let them play with the public a little bit. And it's hard to keep a muzzle on a gorilla, though. Their head is, their head, male gorilla gets where you can't keep a muzzle on them. That's me. Me and one of them, oh yeah, I remember this little episode, training him to wrestle. That may have been Tommy or Majingo. That might have been Majingo. Teaching Majingo to wrestle. Yeah. Get rougher and rougher and rougher. I get rougher, you get my shirt. He gets rougher. Thank you. Mary McFay is the people I bought the booth from. And this is Aunt Ruth and Uncle Palmer sitting, getting ready to watch the Gasparilla Motorcycle Parade, Tampa, Florida. And this was the year that I rode in the parade and led the parade with a group of about 10 fellows on motorcycles, Harley Davidson's, part of the Gasparilla Motorcycle Club. We led the Gasparilla Motorcycle Parade. Uncle Palmer and Aunt Ruth from the Florida to see the sights, enjoy the warm weather. Eating peanuts. Very early, so they got him a good front row seat. Roy Rogers rode in the parade, and Uncle Palmer ran out and shook his hand. Yeah, here comes the motorcycles. I don't know what that is. Or that. It's like part of the Page Combined Shows bunch. Cooking hot dogs. Cooking hot dogs. What do you know, we did have some campfires occasionally. Cooking a hot dog right there on one. Sister, Valadetto. I'm gonna back up and get another, well, let's see, there's a good shot. I guess that was me standing out there. Must have been Christmas. Got him a new, Robert got a tractor for Christmas. Must have bought it for him up to the zoo, so we took him up to the zoo there. And a hobby jumpy horsey. Well, there's Granddaddy Roach. And of course we have some willows. Oh, golly, snakes alive. Poor little Robert, huh? Will he bite, Daddy? No, he won't bite. In the cage, early on, and, this would have been probably Snooky. Now that's the gorilla, believe it or not. Very seldom we ever use a gorilla at all, so that's why they took some pictures of it. He had the muzzle on him and put some local kids in with a gorilla. Early stage training stages playing with a gorilla. Not like the chimps at all. Actually, it's a play match. Daddy played with him, he tore Daddy's shirt off. Young animal, one-third grown. trying to get him broke in. That's Majingo. Good animal. A little different than the other gorilla. They look a little different. They all don't look alike. They're like people. They all have their own distinct expressions and all, and Majingo was different. He wasn't like Tommy. He wasn't like Umbum. A good animal. I think he'd have been a good animal when he was growing, too. I think he'd have been a good animal. Trying to get his white shirt. If he can get his shirt, he'll tear his shirt off. That was a standard procedure. Get the shirt, tear it off. He's in the house trailer here at this, on the couch in the front of the house trailer. Probably in that Spark house trailer. I'm not sure. That's what it looks like. Putting a muzzle on him there. And Robert's going up to play with him. There's no way that the animals would be rough on a young person. Handling very tenderly. Two fingers off my father's right hand that was done by a chimp. Never had the gorilla's bite. He holding on. Robert said, "No, that's enough. Let me get out of here. Come over here." "No, I don't know what I'm doing over here. I don't want to be over here. I got no business over here." Stand up straight. Stand right on his hind legs. Stand up straight. He was one that particular gorilla would walk right straight up on his hind legs, just like somebody. Of course, he wouldn't walk for long periods of time. The hind legs wasn't built to carry their weight. Go back to mama. Gorilla saying, "Leave him alone, leave him alone." Come here. I guess that's me there. Boy, I'm not sure who that is underneath there. I'll know in a minute. Still don't know. Still laying there. No, I don't believe that's me. But it could have been. Oh, don't believe that's me. common occurrence. Everybody could play with the animals. This particular one liked to play kind of rough. He's a young animal there. No more than a little over a third grown. Not half grown yet. And he could play a rough game with you. He really enjoyed playing rough. But see there, now Daddy told him to get on his back, and he got on his back. They can kind of understand you. The chimps actually do understand you. I know that probably the gorillas too. They got older. This is not something you'll see many places around the world, and probably never see it again now. That was Majingo. Good animal. Maybe a little smarter than some of the other gorillas. I don't know. He's a pretty smart animal. Gorilla and a chimp. Little chimp didn't quite trust him. He's too big for him. Oh, and it wasn't our chimp either. I believe that this chimp belonged to someone else. An act that was on a circus or something brought his chimp over. So the chimp was very skeptical of the gorilla. If it had been ours, he probably would have been around him a whole lot. They would have played together, but this little chimp didn't know what to think about that big black thing sitting there. Kind of threatening there. He's tired of fooling around. He's threatening right there. That's a threat. You know, what are you making me do? Yeah, this was that chimp act. This was a chimp riding a bucking bronco dog. Cowboys and Indians. Little Indian on that. He could hold on to that dog pretty good. Dress the dog up like a lion, too, and he should be a lion trainer. The background there is the semi-trailer that me and the wife lived in when we had Robert. And we lived in the front of it, up in the gooseneck, and lived in it for several years, and the trailer stayed at the zoo for a long time then. It was made to carry soldiers during the war. It wasn't very tall, but it was long. Here's the lion. The lion that looks like a dog. Dog that looks like a lion. Roll over, lion, roll over. Oh, okay. This was the chimp act. This is a gorilla playing with a chimp, and little chimp David, he wants to get away, but he's holding on to him. It wouldn't hurt him. No danger to him hurting him at all. Play together like kids play together. The only thing is, when one of them gets you, sometimes they don't want to let you leave, because once you leave, they want to keep the company. They don't want to be staked out there by themselves. They like company. Like to have somebody with them, talking to them, playing with them. Or an animal, dog, cat, or another little chimp or whatever. This little midget fella on the show, a little baby, little chimp was as big as the midget. This fella was no more than 28, 30 inches high. Very, very little guy. Five gypsy families with page combined shows when we were over there about 35 years ago. There was whole clans, two or three family names of gypsies, and they had games and different things. Some of the people around the page combined shows, and that's this is Ben Davenport's stuff here. That's Ben Davenport there. Don't see his head, but that's him. And this must have been the camera they were doing a lot of cutting their heads off. Didn't raise the camera up high enough. That's Ben Davenport. Ben Davenport owned Daly Brothers Circus at one time. Well, that lion killed a kid, Daddy said. Kid run out front of the sidewall and grabbed it and killed it. I don't know what we're looking at here. Back to the Willowville. It's a fat animal there. Two little chimps playing there. Oh, a chimp and a gorilla. The young gorilla. It's a common occurrence around the show. The chimps would be tied out, the gorilla would be tied out, some of them would be loose. The big ones in a cage. I'm not sure which show this is. Ben Davenport. Slow this thing down. Cutting their heads off. Two brothers. Doc Ettling's the man that raised my father, and his two brothers all have passed away. And the panel truck in the background that you saw back there, I used to take that out and run around through the country roads all over, and had speakers on it, and we'd tell them at the free show tonight that wherever we were playing, some little crossroad towns, somewhere in Virginia, North Carolina, Georgia, wherever. And we get a crowd at night. Usually stay a week in a place. This is somebody's circus, whose circus I don't know. Miller Brothers. Miller Brothers, Three Ring Circus. Pretty good size show. Not as big as Daly Brothers. Looks like Christopher. Maybe it's Robert, I can't tell. Somewhere around the circus. Now this is Jimmy Lester. Stop by and see. Now someplace. No, that's not Jimmy Lester. That's my mother's grandmother. my mother's grandmother, so that'd be my great-grandmother, not my grandmother. My mother's grandmother would be my great-grandmother. I think she lived in North Carolina, Durham. Maybe I'm wrong. Relatives on my mother's side, which I never knew very well. If I ever saw them, it was only for an hour or so. In the Bronx. That's where she lives. That's in the Bronx, New York City. So that's the other, I guess that's her other grandmother, because one of them lived in North Carolina. And that's Philip Carroll on the right, and they're the people. Philip Carroll went over to Africa and brought the animals back, the baby gorillas, and he worked for Trefflich out of New York City, and my parents bought some of the earlier gorillas from Trefflich, if I'm saying it right. He's an animal importer, and Phil Carroll was the one that went over, lived in the bush, way in the center of the Congo and Central Africa, and would bring back the baby gorillas, and that's what he has right there, one right there. Phil Carroll, I knew pretty well. He lived in St. Louis, Missouri when he was here, had a wife there, but he spent most of his time in Africa. We crated up one light plant and sent over to him. He told a lot of stories about in the bush in Africa. Back in the bush. A lot of interesting stories. Gorilla skulls, they would kill the big ones, take the little ones, and they'd eat them. The Africans, the natives over there, would actually cook the meat on the skull and eat the meat off the skull. And I guess they still do it today, I guess. Must be Trefflich's wife. I knew Philip Carroll real well. I did not know Henry Trefflich. Don't even know how to say his. That's Phil Carroll there. Trefflich on the right. That's little David there, chimp. Playing with the puppy dog. That's when they went in to get the animals. Took some pictures there. New York City. And Ernestine, when he was down in Florida on a motorcycle back about 1949 or 50, about 1950. And then we're back up, I'm not sure where this was taken, but Orang went up the tree and didn't come down till the next day. That's Bubs there, my mother's brother, sewing up a tent. Little circus we used to go with, I guess possibly it was Hoxie Brothers, I'm not sure. Coon there in red. Now that's something I wouldn't trust, that coon will bite you. Must got along all right. Now we're in a cage here with one of the chimps, it looks like. And this was two little fellas that worked for us. This wasn't a real legitimate go around here. Alfonso B. Duck was that young man's name there. And George with the lighter colored shirt on. And they're in there playing, most likely with Snooky. Snooky could do whatever was necessary to do. He could be rough, he could be easy, he could play with him, he could be... Of course, in a situation like this, this was just a play thing. Play. It wasn't rough. I hate to say it, but I was wrong. That's Joe. That's not Snooky. We didn't usually put gloves on Snooky. And Joe was the one that jumped rope. That's also the one that bit my father. Father of the first baby chimp. That's me and Snooky there. Now that's Snooky for sure. And that's me and Snooky. We kind of grew up together. Me and Snooky were pretty good friends, real good friends. And I think Snooky bit everybody but me. Never bit me. I always had a sailor cap on that back then, and that's Snooky's got my hat on right there. Got an outside wrestling match here now, and it's. Sister and the dogs. There's Mr. Holland's trailer in the background there. This was at a drive-in theater in Wilmington, North Carolina. Mr. Holland, E.S. Holland built some drive-in theaters, the early ones, the earliest drive-in theaters built through the Carolinas there and sold them. Did all right. You go in, buy a piece of property, and develop it, and develop it for a drive-in theater. Put the speakers up on the screen. Alice, that's me, in the semi. The animals was in that red semi. Congo there when he was very young, and my mother. Congo in the baby basket there. She took him every place, just like you'd take a kid. Just kept him covered up so people didn't realize what it was. And every once in a while, a person would come along and pull the covers off and look at it, wanting to see the pretty little baby she had. And just some of them would almost faint. some of the people when they'd pull the cover back on that thing's face, expecting to see a little baby. That was a little baby, all right. Boy, some of them really would. This was taken on 79th Street in Miami at the Tropical Bird and Monkey Farm. It was a place we wintered, a couple of winters. Winters of 47 and 48 before we came to Clearwater. I think we came to Clearwater in the winter of 48, 49, 49, 50. Sister with the two birds back to Congo. Hey, she went on an airplane, he went with her. She went to the theater, he went with her. No matter where Mama went, she took Congo just like it was a baby. Well, it was a baby. High chair there. I think Mustard and Gravy bought the high chair for Congo. Mustard and Gravy was two black-faced comedians from Wilson, North Carolina, that had a little tent show. It was on the radio. They went out and made a couple of movies in California, and they were quite popular through the southern, the eastern seaboard there of North Carolina. And this is Mustard's the Mustard boy there on the right, Ernest Stokes, I believe is the name, or Frank Rice. The Hudson in the background, each of them had a Hudson just alike. Well, they had two Hudsons. This is one of them's wife, the mother of the boy there, handing the basket to her. Picture taken along about 1950. And this is Gravy's wife. They were black-faced comedians, and they were a couple of Western movies that they played in California. They paid them enough money to get out there and get back. They didn't. This lady was on the show. She had three little girls, I believe it was. And that's the house trailer they lived in there. One girl about that big, and one about this big. Don't remember their names. Don't remember what part they played. I think their father put the tent up and down. I'm not sure. About so big. Great, that's Gravy. Mustard. Hoxie Tucker, I think, coming up. Hoxie Tucker on the tent. See the Mustard and Gravy on the semi in the background, and then my father there, he takes the basket, and that's got Congo in it. Congo all dressed up like a baby. Sister. Oh, I believe this is where Sister is the elephant trainer. Yeah, she's going to be the elephant trainer. I don't know about these people that let their kids do these kind of things. You have to look at this and form your own opinion. Back to 79th Street, Miami. Winter months of about 1949 or 50. Young elephant, hasn't been well trained yet. They're breaking the elephant in, working with it every day. And somebody says, well, here, let's see if the elephant will perform for the young lady. So, okay, sure. Why not? Well, now all this isn't so bad, but it gets more interesting here now. This is the part coming up here in a moment that we need to get someone, give me the stick, the elephant hook. got a hook on the end. You hook them and make them come with you. That truck in the background there, my mother drove that and pulled her house trailer with it. Rear end tore up on it, so we went all season long with the front wheel drive only. Now this part here is the part that's interesting. This is here. Maybe, I don't know, maybe they just bought an insurance policy on her. I'm not sure just what happened. But, whatever, the elephant seemed like it was maybe more cautious and a little, well, I don't know, maybe even smarter than the people they're trying to hear. If we didn't get it that time, we'll come back for a second shot at it. Here, get up here on the vital parts. Don't be down there around the feet. So the elephant, very cautiously, and sister gets a little nervous, and sister at about this point in time says, wait a minute, what am I doing down here? It's time to make a move. Ta-da! Fantastic scenes here. This is a solid tired truck. It's the house truck, my grandfather's. It has a piece of rubber missing about 6 or 8 inches long on one wheel. So it goes down the road jumping like a jackrabbit. And someplace there in North Carolina, here comes the truck jumping down the road. And there it is, jumping down the road, going down the road. That truck wound up at Cedar Island, North Carolina. It was an old Macker White, and it run a sawmill there for about 25 years after. No, it was a Federal. It was an old Federal. Johnny cranking it up there. I don't know where my grandfather got that truck from. It's about played out. He got out of it jumping. He says, well, my goodness, will it make it any further? I think I'll just take it easy right here and take a nap. Jack Roach. Johnny Roach. Johnny was a good-looking young man there. Well, Johnny, I've been thinking about you. Not getting around too good. I'm going to get you one of these, get you this thing up here and bring back old times and old memories. Pinky? Because everybody's got a VCR now, and I'm going to make you a copy and send it to you. Mary and Jack? Mary was a beautiful girl there. Young lady, about 35 or so, 40 maybe. Someone that was a helper for Granddaddy, and I don't remember his name, but if I remember right, he was a human pincushion. He's one that would poke pins through his skin. Didn't have any teeth, that's for sure. This fellow's name was Red something. About half snockered all the time, I think. He was had a tattoo of a star on his face there. Texas Ella? They own a little show. This, her husband put the tent up and down for Hoxie or somebody. Show people from way back when. And the old great name. And here's those soldiers back in 1943 in Texas. My parents came across these soldiers with their horses. So where they spent the night, my parents set the show up. And I remember very well they had no way to go. They were very tired, so I went and got them to the store. I went to the store for them, and they gave me a nickel or a dime or something for going, and I made $2.80. I remember that real well. I run to the store many times for them. And all of those guys went to Europe, and very few, if any, came back. Well, there is Shirley Poindexter, Bobby Noell, and I guess that sister on the left, our first snowstorm, first snow up in Virginia, where we went to school there, about the second grade or so, built a snowman in front of my Aunt Annie's house, which is no longer in the family now, it's been sold. She had a nice big farm there, and Shirley right now is the only one left of the family. There was three sons, and mother and father, and Shirley, the youngest son, is the only one left. And he's about my age. He's about 57, 58 years old now. Now being 1991. There's Joe walking on his front hands. It's after the snow melted, I guess. Probably the same winter, though. Joe was a performer at the St. Louis Zoo, and he got a little hard for them to handle, so they sell him when they got a little bit stubborn. So my father bought Joe turkeys on the farm, and he rode a bicycle, roller skates, walked on his front hands, jump rope, and did a number of things he was trained to do. It wasn't uncommon at all to see Daddy riding around on some type of motorbike. That was a scooter, something that you could get back right after the war or during the war years. Wasn't much transportation back then. You couldn't buy much. That's Joe and Susie, mother and father of Congo. Chanda the Magician, a couple of old vaudeville show people that used to go with my parents and put on a show, and he would peddle magic tricks to the crowd. Well, my mother make some funny faces at us. Russell. Bob Russell. I think that little motorbike was a Simplex made in New Orleans, Louisiana in the 40s. Holland, E.S. Holland. Can't think of that man's name. I know him, but can't think of his name. There's Holland's house trailer. Holland and the other fellow's a Wrestler, I believe, and Daddy's little Crosley car. And he used to put that little Crosley in the back of the trailer, back of the truck, carry it from one spot to the other. I'm not sure who they were. That's Annie. That's Sis. That's Daddy and Snooky. That's Annie and Aunt Ruth. That's George playing with Snooky. George was the farm helper. I believe his mother's name was Minnie, and I think she had 5 or 6, 7 or 8. Had quite a house full of kids. And George helped at Aunt Annie's farm for many years. some people don't think he was compensated as well as he should have been at the end either. That was the object to pin him, but Snooky really didn't care there. Snooky was playing. He certainly wasn't putting up much of a battle. George again. A chimp that size could give you, that's Billy Wayne. Billy Wayne died of leukemia not long after this picture was taken. This picture was taken about 1944. That's an educated guess, I don't know exactly. Aunt Ruth and Bob Noell. Good picture. The horses. Annie had some big horses there that used to pull the wagons. Snooky had the horses buffaloed. Oh, I'm not sure, but I think that's Aunt Pete's daughter. I'm not sure. Looks like the film was going crazy. Mae Noell. Film got a little old on these pictures. Well, I guess that's me. God, what a handsome young guy. Yeah. Look in the mirror now, I haven't changed that much. The nose is still in the middle of the face anyway. Back to Billy Wayne. And his mother. Roma. Aunt Ruth. And Daddy.
And Annie.
Not a good picture of Annie. That's the best one I've come across, but not too good. Got a chicken behind up in front of the camera. She was cleaning chickens. She was always working at Aunt Sis. Aunt Sis lived about 3,000 feet from Aunt Annie, less than a half a mile. She also was cleaning chickens. Must have been getting ready to have a cook some chicken. My relatives on my mother's side, her aunt, her cousins, or something like that, relatives she went to see in New York City about 25 years ago. Well, there's Betty Irene Tucker, Hoxie Tucker's wife. People around the show, and I just don't remember the names. But there's Hoxie, Daddy, Betty. Wonder where we were at. Some little town. Maybe it was Chinky Pin. There's me in the background. What do you know? I didn't remember those Hudsons being convertibles, but I guess they were. Film, they're all pretty good, really. Little house trailer. It was a big house trailer back then, I guess. Barefooted in the grass. Congo again. That's George, the fellow that used to go with us, and he'd wrestle a bear. He put the leather coat on because the bear would sink his teeth into you a little bit. So he put the coat in his mouth, made it a little safer. Bear liked to play too. Bear really liked fish. If I'd catch some minnows, I'd put them in a Pepsi bottle and put some water in it and give him something to drink out of the Pepsi bottle. And when he'd get to a minnow, he would really go crazy. He really liked to eat little fish in a Pepsi Cola bottle. course, he'd hold his own bottle, too, like Pepsi or Coke or whatever, like there. He'd drink Pepsi-Cola. He liked Pepsi-Cola or Coca-Cola. He liked anything sweet, more or less. They certainly liked syrup or honey or anything like that. They used to give him some water, though, in a Pepsi bottle. If I could catch some minnows, they sure enjoyed that. They weren't as playful as the chimps or gorillas, but you could play with a bear. If he got your hand, though, he'd bite your hand harder than you wanted. That's me and George. No, that's not me. That's George and Alfonso B. Duck. I usually wore a cowboy hat like that. Sailor hat. Alfonso B. Duck from South Carolina, near Charleston. Not sure where George was from. I think Alfonso was probably Geechee. Doc Etling. Sister, family folks, that thing is this. Uncle Lawrence, it's like we have out there. Uncle Sweetie's had us a get together and everybody brought something to eat. They used to do that every Sunday. In the summertime, all either go out to Sweetie's or go to the country, maybe go to Sis's or maybe go to Annie's or maybe everybody go to Bedford Lake. I don't know all these people. I don't know where this was taken. These are all, there's Annie. Must have been a church get together or something. Like they had plenty to eat. There's Aunt Pete in the middle there. Is that Cecil? I believe that's Cecil.